Hi, this is Abhilash Majumdar. I'm a research scientist working for Morgan Stanley. Previously, I was working on NLP and deep learning projects at HSBC Holdings. I used to collaborate with Google Research on their language models like BERT and Albert. And I have been mentoring professionals and students on NLP, deep learning, and AI for organizations like Udemy, Udacity, and UpGrad for quite some time. So I have quite some experience in this regard. So, and also welcome to Co-Learning Lounge. Channel. So in this channel, we will be posting regularly on different complex topics like transformers, attention. And today's topic is going to be about ELMO. So you can connect with me in the description given below. Also, feel free to subscribe to this channel and also provide feedbacks to this video. So in this post, we are going to talk about deep contextualized word embeddings representations, which is called as ELMO. Now, the drawbacks of GLOVE or static pre-trained embeddings gave rise to this idea of ELMO. And ELMO was devised by Peters et al. From Google Research. And this model is readily available on TensorFlow Hub and can be downloaded and used. So ELMO is a different analogical embedding as compared to GLOVE. The difference comes into the factor that GLOVE, Word2Vec, these kinds of embeddings generally do not take into consideration the context. So global semantics of the particular corpus or a particular topic is taken into consideration, but local context or the change in word embeddings with respect to different contexts are not taken into consideration in Word2Vec or GLOVE. So in this way, embeddings learned from large-scale neural language models that can be extremely effective representations of semi-supervised transfer learning. And ELMO vectors are added to basically any NLP tasks to boost up accuracy, to boost up any sentiment classification tasks, as well as language modeling, NSP, and any tasks related to semi-supervised language modeling. Now, ELMO has some internal details, like how it is different than GLOVE, because if we were to consider two sentences containing river banks, so one where the bank represents a bank of a river, and other bank represents a financial organization, so this difference is clearly conveyed by using ELMO, because ELMO picks up contextual embeddings rather than picking up global embeddings or global semantics. So the ELMO architecture is fairly a broad architecture consisting of layers of LSTMs, which we studied in the previous video. LSTMs have this beautiful property of memory retention, holding important information pieces for longer time spans, and effectively used for large corpuses. So language model training is done effectively with ELMO architecture, and it is heavily inspired by previous work on large-scale new language models. So if we go forward with this, then you can see that this example, such as models, allow you to determine that if you see the phrase, I am going to write with a, where I am going to write with a is a phrase, right? And there is a blank after that. The NSP or the next word prediction would be pencil or pen or any relevant word. Now, this relevant word gets picked up from the trained corpuses or pre-trained embeddings corpuses with respect to contexts. So that is why it is very important. So architecturally, the ELMO consists of stacks of LSTM networks. So LSTM networks, as we saw, had four different gates, the input gate, the forget gate, the cell gate, which updates the cell state, and also the output gate. And it outputs two different cell states, that is a cell state C and the hidden cell state for the current LSTM timestamp H. But there is a difference. The ELMO paper specifies that ELMO runs separate multi-layered forward and backward LSTMs. This is also known as bidirectional LSTMs. So effectively what bidirectional LSTMs do is that they take the context of the forward word, that is the word which is ahead of it, as well as the word which is back or at the look back of it. So in this way, they give bidirectional embeddings or bidirectional representations pertaining to a particular word. This can be simplified in the image that we see here. So in this case, the cat is happy is a certain phrase. So this forward pass or the forward LSTM, this calculates as a normal LSTM where we have this as the initial cell C0. This is the next LSTM cell C1, and this is cell C2 and C3. So progressively it goes from C0 to C3. And bidirectional cells happen in the reverse order. In bidirectional manner, in the reverse, there is a reverse stack of LSTM cells which are coming into the picture. So it starts from cell C3 and it goes progressively to cell C2, C1, and C0. So whatever gets the output over here in the forward LSTM cells at C3 is the input for cell C3 in the backward LSTM stack of cells. So in this way, a bidirectional representation comes into the picture. So the weights, that is the C and the H channels of a particular LSTM output, are being fed in a reverse manner to the previous LSTM stack of cells to maintain bidirectionality. And this gives, you know, the context pertaining to a particular word with respect to 2-3 words before it, as well as 2-3 words after it. And this is one of the most important concepts of having ELMO. So it allows a separate multi-layered forward and backward LSTMs. And what it does after that is concatenates the representations at each layer. So whatever we have for this particular layer of stacked LSTMs, forward and backward LSTMs together, the outputs are then stacked together. They are concatenated together. So effectively, you get a combined tuple or a combined tensor containing of cell states C and H of both the forward layers as well as the backward states of LSTM. And this is different from running a layer of forward and backward cells, concatenating them. So this does not mean that, you know, for each every cell, we are taking the bidirectionality, we're taking the forward LSTMs and the backward LSTMs, and we're merging them and then concatenating them. That is not the correct idea over here. But LSTMs, effectively, what they do is take the feed forward and the backward LSTMs, that is bidirectionality, and then concatenates the representations at each layer. That means for each and every layer, this is a particular layer of stacked bidirectional cells of LSTM. This is concatenated first, and then the output is progressed to the next stack of bidirectional LSTM cells. And this is a very important idea because bidirectional LSTM cells, as I mentioned, represents the contextual information and stores that information for a longer timestamp. In traditional neural language models, where we have NSP, next language prediction. So in this case, each token in the first input character is converted to a fixed length word embedding, because passed into the recurrent unit or any variant of GRUs or LSTMs. We have seen this in the case of glove, where we use a pre-trained static word embedding, right? And we build a embedding vector out of it, embedding matrix out of it. And then we allow to pass through any deep or simple neural network layers like convolution, LSTMs, and all these kinds of things. However, for ELMO language model, we do something a little bit more complex. So in this case, we apply a word embedding matrix, and we first convert these individual word embeddings to character-based embeddings. So character-based embeddings not only compute the word morphology for a particular word, as well as it also allows out of the word vocabulary, which may not be present in standard vocabularies, to be embedded properly. So it creates a proper embedding matrix with respect to characters instead of words. And then after this character embeddings are created by ELMO, what we do is apply a convolutional layer. Convolutional layer is pretty much similar to a neural network architecture, which picks up certain important information in window sizes or in window strikes. So in the case of image processing or image segmentation, there is a lot of use of convolution neural networks, which tries to convolve around certain window sized pixels of image and picks up or abstracts certain information from that particular range of pixels. So similar idea comes into the picture here as well. We apply the convolutional layer on the character embeddings using some number of filters and also some window strides. And this is followed by a max pool layer. Max pool effectively means that we are taking the maximum from a range or a window. So this representation is passed through a highway network. So effectively, the diagram for a particular ELMO embedding is like this. So first, we apply a character embeddings. Then we apply a convolutional neural network with maximum pooling. That means we are taking the values in a pool, the maximum values in a pool of, let's say, any window size through the convolutional layer. And then we are passing through a highway network. So this highway network, I will come to the bit in a little bit. And then we are passing the output of a highway network to the stacked bidirectional LSTMs concatenated together. So this is the entire architecture of ELMO. So first is character embeddings. Then we apply convolutional layer with max pooling. Then we have a two-way highway network, and then we have a stacked bidirectional LSTMs, where the weights are getting concatenated at each step of bidirectional LSTM layers. Now, coming to highway network, this is actually one advancement done by Schmidhuber, the inventor of LSTMs. So, what highway networks generally do is they attain and restrict more information. Right? How they do this is by applying something called as two different gates. So there is a carry gate and there is a transfer gate. So when we have a normal feedforward neural network, let's say a dense simple neural network where we are applying a sigmoid activation on the weights plus the biases, like sigmoid function weights into the inputs plus the biases, this is our standard feedforward dense neural network. And this and the difference of highway networks is that we are applying two gates on it. The first is a transfer gate, which is nothing but a transfer tensor. And then we are applying a carry gate. The carry gate is effectively taken as 1 minus transfer gate. So effectively, the weight that we are getting in the standard MLP or a standard dense feedforward neural network, we are multiplying it with two gates, that is the transfer gate and a carry gate. So this transfer and carry gate have certain important properties, which is mentioned in this paper over here. So this also gives you an important idea that when we're initializing a highway network with negative C value or negative carry value, we are allowing more signals or more characters to be passed as carry in the carry state rather than the transfer state. So this allows proper and efficient restoration of memory as well as storage of information for longer timestamp. This is a slight advancement over the standard architecture, which involved convolutional, and then we have bidirectionality, so bidirectional LSTMs. So this two-way highway network is effectively like an efficient deep learning module inside it, consisting of two gates, that is the transfer gate and the carryover gate, which provides added information collection and information gain. So these transformations of the input tokens have a number of advantages. So character embeddings, as I mentioned, it not only picks up the morphological features that word level could miss, but also character level embeddings ensures that a valid representation of out of the vocabulary words are present. So these also include the words which are not present in standard corpuses like Wikipedia or news corpuses or large corpuses of text. So convolutional filters allow us to pick up n-gram features like in a window manner or by using certain filter sizes, which picks up and abstracts certain more powerful representations. The highway network allows for smoother information transfer and also information retention in the input. Then the core idea of bidirectional stacked LSTM cells that we mentioned comes into the picture. So all of this is quite complex when we consider the LSTM to be a simple model. The LSTM is effectively a complex architecture which employs bidirectional LSTMs to have certain memory retention capacities added with some important ingredients like convolutional networks, highway networks to boost up contextual representations. And mathematically, there is some important features of how the concatenation at the bidirectional LSTM cells takes place in ELMO. So we are looking at the kth word of the input, let's say. So that kth word can be the or a cat or any word. So using our trained two-layer language model, we can take the word representations, that is the XK. So for in this image that you see, in this particular stacked bidirectional LSTM cells, is the first stacked layers, if we just concatenated the outputs, then this will be H1. And we have the inputs, that is the H. Again, there is another stacked LSTM, bidirectional LSTM cells on top of it. So this is H2, the output of the hidden cell state is collected again. And these are computed and concatenated again by using this F. So this F is nothing but an activation unit, which applies a nonlinear transformation on the hidden states combined with the input states. And the rest of the idea is pretty much simple to what a general LSTM architecture looks like. So we are combining the hidden states of all the stacked bidirectional cells, we're concatenating them, and we are passing it through an activation unit. And effectively, this activation unit is termed as a softmax activation unit. So to be more concrete about the mathematical details, the function F performs the following operation. So for each this S0 task, it effectively means that I'm applying a softmax on the H, that is the hidden cell state, and I'm concatenating it with the input XK features. Similarly for S1, that is, it takes the H1 and it applies a softmax on it. And then it does the similar way for H2 as well. So every individual step that we see of bidirectional stacked cells, a softmax activation is applied on this H2, H1, and all the hidden cell states of bidirectional stacked LSTMs. And the output is passed through a gamma. So gamma is specifically a scaling factor, which is done as a hyperparameter in ELMO for fine-tuning tasks. But effectively, this is how the entire language model of ELMO and embeddings occur. And this is the entire idea, where we have input vectors. We create the character embeddings from the input vectors. And then we apply convolutional networks with max pooling to allow more selective information retention. we apply a highway network for smooth transfer of tensors, weights, and also for retention of certain important features of the word, right? And then we apply certain things called as bidirectional stacked LSTMs on top of each other. We concatenate the weights or the concatenated the outputs of the individual hidden cell states of all the bidirectional stacked LSTMs. And we concatenate them with the output. We take the softmax activations of H1, H2, and these two particular cells, right? And then we concatenate with the input that we have, that is X happy. And then we apply the embeddings. So this is how the ELMO embeddings comes into the picture. And this is how the ELMO embeddings architecturally is built. And the rest of the details regarding how LSTM performs is already mentioned in the previous video. So ELMO is built, is trained. First off, the ELMO language model is trained on a sizable data set. That is the 1 billion word benchmark, which is a very popular benchmark in NLP. So in addition, the language models are really large in the sense that LSTM containing 4096 units and input embedding transforms up to 2048 convolutional filters. So it is quite a large model containing number of billions of parameters. I say millions of parameters. Here we can imagine the residual connection between the first and the second LSTM layer is quite important. So residual connections is nothing but a smooth transfer of certain tensors and certain weights by using some identity transformations. So we will not get into the residual information or how residual connections work, but this idea is taken again from image and image processing where we have residual networks. So initially the LSTMs, they pick up certain important information and the bidirectionality adds to that. And then we concatenate the different hidden cell states of these stacked bidirectional LSTMs and we concatenate the inputs to get the output. So ELMO is effectively a very large model. And this is all that I needed to cover regarding how ELMO is built, how ELMO works internally, what are the mathematical formulations of each and every different layer of ELMO. So with this, I conclude this video and I hope to see you in the next video tutorial. Thank you.